Welcome to Workshop 12 on Data Structures and Algorithms. In today's workshop, we'll be looking at another searching technique known as hash tables. At the completion of today's workshop, you should be able to design and implement a hash function. You should also be able to resolve collisions in a hash table using different approaches. And lastly, you should be able to differentiate between hash tables and other searching techniques that we have used to search for an item in data structures. Before now, we have studied different approaches to search for an item in a data structure. We have also looked at their efficiencies. One of these approaches that we've studied is the linear search techniques. So if you want to use a linear search technique to search for an item in an unsorted array, we've come to understand that the efficiency is of log is of order of n. Then to improve the efficiency of this searching of a searching techniques, the binary approach can be applied. The binary approach reduced the searching techniques or the searching complexity to the order of log n, which means it increased the efficiency of the search techniques. However, this increase in efficiency is at the cost of sorting the data before the binary operation is performed on the data. So the big question now is, which way, or is there any other searching techniques that can still minimize the complexity of the searching approaches? Which, in other way, we can say, is there any other way or any other techniques that we can use to increase the efficiency of the searching techniques? This is the reason we are studying these hashing techniques. Still on this linear and the binary search, we have come to realize again that each comparison we make using linear search will end up reducing the search space by one. But if in each comparison we made using the binary search, the searching space is reduced by half. We have also come to understand that if an item is to be retrieved from an array, that the complexity for linear search is of the order of n, but the complexity for binary search is of the order of log n. Then if we can employ the idea of indexing the element in the array, then the possibility of reducing the complexity to the order of one can come in. At the same time, if we want to insert an item into an array, the possibility of reducing the complexity to the order of one for unsorted item is also possible. Then, if this is possible, which of these data structure or techniques is capable of providing such solution? One of them is the hashing approach. So the hashing approach involves using an array for the efficient storage and retrieval of information. Information here is also referring to elements or data items in a data structure. So for the ideal case scenario to retrieve and store an element into an array has the efficiency of of order of one. That is when using hashing techniques. So these hashing techniques also makes use of mapping approach, where the key or the data item is mapped to the index of the array. In subsequent slides, we're going to see examples how this mapping operation can be done. But the mapping will not keep the data in a sorted, a sorted array of the data. So the array will not, the data will not be in a sorted form. Now, we are going to look at more at the hash table. So let's assume we have a table, a hash table of one-dimensional array of m entries with keys starting from k I, where I is equal to zero to m minus one. And we also have a hash function, which has the responsibility of evenly distributing the keys onto the indices of the array. And the index can, the integer can start from zero to m minus one. So if we have a hash function which is capable of evenly mapping the keys to the indices of an array, then we have ended up forming one-to-one mapping of the keys, because each key will be mapped to each index of the array. Therefore, data with key ki will be sorted, will be stored in the slot of the table, which makes it possible for one to use just one probe to assess any data in that table. So if, in other words, if we know that each data is mapped to an index, then you only require one probe to assess that particular data because you know the location and you know the index value. Now let's look at one example to illustrate the one-to-one mapping. So assuming we have a hash function that can get the value of the index by dividing the key by the module of four. So let's say these are the elements that we have, and this is the table or the hash function table. Now, how do we map these elements being 5, 3, 5, 8, and 10 to this hash table to a point that they will be one-to-one mapping? The approach is that we'll first of all maybe have a list of all the elements that we need to map. Then we find the modular four of those elements. So the modular, for instance, of this one will be the modular of 3 to 4 will give us 3. And the modular for this one, which is 5, don't mind the writing, 2, 4 will give us 1. Because if you divide the module of, if 5 module 4 will be 4, 1 remainder 1, which is 1. The modular for this one is going to be 0. And the modular for 10 will be 2. So these are the values we are going to have as the indices of these elements. This implies that these three can be mapped to the index of the hash table 3. And this 5 can be mapped to the index of the hash table 1. This 8 can be mapped to the index of the hash table 0. And 10 can also be mapped, can then be mapped to the index of the hash table 2. So let's now start with the first one. The key three maps to position three. Then we put an arrow. Three to position three. Then the second one is five being mapped to position one. And the third one is eight being mapped to position zero. And the fourth is 10 being mapped to position two. So you see each of these elements is mapped to a position where they have been inserted. So it becomes easy for one to find or retrieve this element when you want to retrieve them. And it is easy because it requires only one probe. And if it requires one probe, then the efficiency is increased and the complexity is reduced. Let's clear this. Now, if we go to the next slide, we'll now illustrate the case of a collision. Realizing the previous slide, there was no collision. Collision occurs when two or more data items have the same index value. So let's assume that we have these elements here, and you have the module to be four. So this is the table. First, we can say that the module of four is zero, and the module of eight we know is zero, and the module of 10 is two, and the module of three is three. So we start with three. You say the key three can be mapped to position three using the approach we took in the previous slide. We can find the module for three, and it gives us three. So we map it to this three. Then the next one is four. If we find four, we realize that the position goes to zero. So we're going to map four to zero. Then the next we're going to have is eight. But mapping eight to this position, which zero, will cause a conflict. So there is a collision there because four had already occupied that index space. So what do we need to do to solve this problem? That is this, this, you need to find a solution such that each element will be mapped to the index on a one-to-one mode. So if we are to perform that on a one-to-one mode, then we have to do something here such that only one element is mapped to this index. And what can we do? The thing that we can do is to find a technique to move one of them, probably eight, to another slot that is empty. So once we do that, then we can realize one-to-one mapping, and as long as every other element is mapped to one of the indexes. So there are some questions that we need to respond to here. First is, what would happen if 10 is also mapped to position one or position zero? And how will you locate this item? Now let's look at the basic algorithm to store an item within the key KI. The algorithm is, you can have a loop and find the hash function. So if slot H in the table is empty, then you store the item in that slot. So once you find the hash function, you know you can use the hash function to determine the index and the table. So if that index, which is a slot in this case, is empty, then the item will be stored there. Otherwise, it needs to go to the next item and ensure until you have the item stored there. Then how do we locate an item on the hash table? We can use similar operation. First, we evaluate the hash function. And why is slot H not empty? As long as it's not empty, you have to check if that is the item you want to locate. If it's not, then you have to look for the next item, for the next slot. And you continue like that until you get to the last, or you get to a point where H is empty, then, and the item is not in the table. So these are the steps or the approaches that you can take to locate an item within the keys. Now, we had a problem previously, which is the collision problem. And we said that one way to solve it is to find an empty slot and put the data item that collided with another item. But the question again is, how do we go about finding another location? What is the techniques? How are we going to do it? That is the question. So before we go about learning how we do it, we'll first of all look at what the hash function is, or what a hash function is, because we're going to use some hash functions to learn how or to perform this operation. So a good hash function must be performed quickly, and it should be easy to compute. That is one thing that a good hash function must have. Another thing is that it must minimize collisions. We saw in the other time that there was a collision. So a good hash function must minimize collision. Thirdly, a good hash function must achieve an evenly distributed or distribution of the keys. Because we know that the aim is to reach or obtain a point where the storage and the retrieval of data is of the efficiency of one. Now, let's look at these hash functions. One of them is the truncation. But the truncation ignores part of the key and uses remaining part as the hash value. So this is how the truncation works. It happens to be fast, but it fails to distribute the keys evenly. So you remember that in the previous slide, we said that one of the good quality of a hash function is that it must distribute the keys evenly. But this first one cannot distribute the keys evenly or uniformly. And the next one is folding. The folding splits key into several parts and then combine the part to obtain the hash value. This often gives better spread than the truncation. And then last in our list is the modular arithmetic. The modular arithmetic divides key by table size. So it takes the key and divides it by the size of the table. In the previous ones we did, we used 4. So the size of the table is 4. So it takes the key and divides it by that size of the table using the modular approach. So it uses remainder as the hash value. So whatever remains after dividing it is what it uses as the hash value. One good thing about this modular arithmetic is that it is good for spreading. So it is good for performing evenly distribution, uniform distribution of the keys. Now, continuing on how we want to solve this collision. So different approaches are used to solve collision. One of them is the chaining approach. This churning approach is sometimes called closed addressing. Another approach is the open addressing. Under open addressing, you have linear probing, quadratic probing, double hashing, and random rehashing. These are the ones we are going to look at in this study. Now let's start with the first one, which is the churning. So we have this to illustrate the churning approach. Let us assume we have the size of the table to be 10 in this case. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. It's 10 because we started from 0 to 9. So this is the size of the table. And remember, if you are using modular, then it is the data item. For instance, the first data item we have here is 10, moduled by the size of the table, which is 10. And whatever remains is the position. So what remains after this is 0. So that's the reason we have the first data item at this point. The second data item we have is 42. So it's assumed we have 10, 42. And so on. 22, 14, 34, 54, 24, and the rest. So the 10, the first one, which is 10 mod 10, will give us 0. And the second one is 42 mod 10. If you perform 42 mod 10, you're going to have 2, right? And if we perform 22 mod 10, you also be left with 2. So the first one is 10. So we have this 10. But because we are using singly linked list to solve the collision, we have to put the diagram in a singly linked list approach or view. And the second one is 42. When we compute the modular for 42, we have 2. So we're going to look at the index of the hashing table and find where we can get 2. This is position for 2. So we have 42. And the next one is 22. So if you find the modular, we have 2. So we move down again and found 2 here. So here that we have 2, we realize that we already have 42 there, then there is a collision. So in order to use this singly linked list to resolve the collision, then we have to extend this link and have 22. Likewise, the next one we have is 14. And 14 divided by 10 is going to give us 4. So this is why we have it here, 4. The same thing will happen to this. We're going to have when we perform the modular operation, we'll be left with 4. So we're going to, 4, we collide with this. To resolve it, we extend it to get this singly linked list here. The same thing happens to this until we get to the end. So why is this called churning? So it is called churning because this is just like a chain. At that point where there is collision, it forms something that looks like a chain that chain them together, but they will still be within the same index. So this is how the chaining operation happens, and this is how it resolves the collision problem in the hash table. And another one is the open addressing. And the first one we're going to look at and the open addressing is the linear probing. So for the linear probing, it makes use of the searching approach to find the next or the another, to find an empty slot where the collided item can be placed. So in the search operation, one important thing we need to look at is this operation here. This operation is very important. This is the step it takes to find the next empty slot where that collided item will be inserted. Now let's look at an example. This example, we have elements 14, 8, 21, 2, 33, and 99. So these are the elements. So they have 6 inputs, but we have the modular to be 7. So which means the size of the table is 7, starting from 0 to 6. Now, how is the operation going to be performed? The operation for linear probing is similar to the previous operation we have done before. We're going to find the modular. So to insert 14, we have 14 modular 7, which is 0. So the index 0 is here, so we insert 14 here. The next element is 8. So the 8 modular 7 is 1. So we have the index 1 and insert the value here, which is 8. The next element now is 21. So if you perform 21 operation, we realize that the index will be 0. And the 0 index has already been occupied by the 14 element. So what do we need to do? One thing we have observed is that collision had happened. And how do we solve this collision? We'll solve this collision by using this formula. I said you should take note of this formula where we have to use the index value plus I. I ranges from 1, 2, 3, and continues. So now we've got to this point. We're going to say that to find another location, we are going to use this approach, which is 0, the index where it happened is 0, plus 1, which is 1. Then we're going to look at the index 1. But at the index 1, we still have another data item positioned there, so which means there is another collision. Then we have to proceed and look for another index. When we increment it by 1, we have 2. And 21 can now be inserted at this point. And the next one is 2. So 2, if you perform the operation for 2, you will have that 2 will give us 2, which implies that it collides with this one. So if increase index where we need to insert the data, then we can perform this operation with 2 plus 1, which is 3. Then 2 can be inserted here. The next data item is 33. So 33 module 7 will be 5. So we find the location for 5 and insert 3. The next one is 99. 99 modular 7 will be 1. So there is collision here. So we're going to move next to the next one and perform the sum operation, and we realize that we have collision. We continue until we get to this place where there is no data item. This is for the linear probing. So the linear probing, why it's called linear probing, is that it goes in linear form. It takes a look at from the point where there's the collision happened, it look at the next point to see if it will insert the data there. If not, it goes to the next point. If not, it goes to the next point until it finds a space or an empty slot where it can insert the data. Then we have to move further to look at another open addressing approach, which is the quadratic probing. So in the case of quadratic probing, which is similar to the linear probing, the only major difference is that instead of using linear increment, it uses square increment. So you remember in the previous one, we had h plus I. Or in this one, we have h plus I square. So this is the major problem, the major difference. So if we still use, if we use the same data that we used in the previous one, so we have the table size to be 7. Then we have our data. The first data to insert is 14. 14 has no problem. And the next data to insert is 1. 1 has no problem. And remember, the third data collided, so it needs to be moved. And so how do we move it? We use the operation formula that the index will be equal to 0, because 0 is where it happened, plus the square of I starts from 1, 2, 3, and so on. So 1 to square is 1, which is going to give us 1. So at this point, we still face collision. So this collision, we employ the indexing again. And if you look at this indexing at this point, we have 4. So we can insert 21 at this index 4. So this is how we continue to perform the operation until we get to the final one, which is where we will have the index 93 being inserted here. So the major difference between this and the linear is the movement to the next empty slot, where the quadratic makes use of square, whereas linear makes use of linear operation. Another type of operation is the double hashing. Double hashing just makes use of two hashing functions. You know, the quadratic makes use of square root square to increment the next search or probing space where we need to insert the data. But in this one, it makes use of two hashing functions. So that's the main thing for the double hashing techniques. So the slot tries H and it tries another one, which is H plus G. The third one will be H plus 2G, and it continues that way. And the last on our list is the random rehashing. Random rehashing picks the increment value by using the pseudo random number to generate it. So it makes use of the pseudo random number to generate the increment value. So this kind of approach is excellent in avoiding collision. However, it is slow. Now we have an activity which is looking at the best case and the worst case scenario for hashing using chaining or linear probing. So the best case scenario from what we have seen is when all the data items are distributed evenly across all the slots. So if you have all the data items completely distributed evenly without collision, then we have gotten the best case scenario. But the worst case scenario is when all the data items are collided with the same slot or the index. So if you have the data item colliding with all of them, colliding with the same, then we have the worst case scenario, because we need to probe and either using chaining to solve the problem in a linked list. We have to use linear probing, or we employ the principle of quadratic probing to solve this problem, or other approaches. So these are the two cases, the best case and the worst case scenario. And another one asks is, consider deleting an item. Would you consider deleting an item from a hash table? If you need to consider deleting an item from a hash table, you first of all have to note that since an empty location is used to make the end of a group of keys, then you cannot just remove the item and leave it empty. So you have to make sure that the item is not left empty. So how do you do that? You can do that by using a special key variable to indicate that that item has been deleted. And if you use such key, and you realize that if you want to perform operation like inserting a new data item or searching for an item within that hash tree, so that position will now be the flag variable will be used to indicate that an element was deleted from that particular space. This is where we're going to end this session. Thank you so much, and see you later.